Now it's time for our regular interview with Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern, who we're very pleased to have with us in our Auckland studio this week to talk about developments on the COVID-19 front, what can be done about runaway house prices and the various international talks she's attended remotely, that is, over the weekend. Morena, Prime Minister, thank you so much for coming into the studio.
Pleasure.
Now before we start, you wanted to clarify something around a story that we've been talking about this morning, that China says it's found COVID-19 on frozen goods from New Zealand.
Yeah.
However, that's not the information that
we've been given.
No,
we've been advised that that's Argentinian beef. So just trying to get to the bottom of what's being reported there as we speak. But, you know, rest assured we'll keep doing that. But to this point, I've been advised it's not our beef, but we'll keep working away on that.
Let's stay with COVID-19. Are there any new developments? We had one new community case from yesterday that was linked to the AUT students.
Correct.
Any new developments?
No,
overnight.
No, and look, that was a close contact we'd already identified, was already in isolation, and we'd proactively tested. And so, as everyone will remember, that's the kind of scenario you want. You want your new cases to be ones that you've already put into isolation, and we're confident that was very early infection, so that means limited the number of then contacts from that person. At this stage, of course, what we're still working on is how do we connect that most recent case that we've had with the worker from our managed isolation facility. We know that they've got basically identical, what they call genomes, so we know that they're connected somehow. We're working on those pieces of the puzzle. We believe we'll be able to build a bit of a picture of what's happened, but that's what we're working on at the moment.
Talk to me about mask wearing.
Yeah.
Now, I know that you've been reluctant to compel us to wear masks, and I note that Minister Hipkin said on our show on Friday that New Zealand is not a police state and that they're relying, well, you're relying on the goodwill of citizens. However,
to a point.
However, he is taking to Cabinet today consideration around making mask wearing compulsory.
Yep.
Is that a sign that we haven't, that goodwill hasn't come from?
No, actually, quite the opposite, because you'll remember we do have compulsory mask use at level two.
Yep.
So when we're in that heightened time, when we're coming out of a situation or we've got a bit of concern around cases in the community, we've been using mask use at level two. What this is actually a sign of is that we're getting we have the ability, as we've seen recently, with a few cases connected to our border, we've had the ability to manage those without going back into alert level two restrictions. But actually that's telling us, well, actually maybe we need to bring some of those precautionary measures down to that level one environment. So that's the reason for it. We know as well that buses, we have been asking people on planes, for instance, I still use them on planes.
Not many people have though. We've had a couple of people travelling from our team over the weekend
wearing
masks, but half the people that have been on planes,
correct. And so we build that into our thinking too. Actually, if we consider it a higher risk environment, even at level one, and people aren't really doing it voluntarily, do we need to do more there? So that's what Cabinet will talk about today. I'm expecting though on public transport in Auckland, on flights, that we'll be asking people to use those masks. And again, it actually just shows us that at level one we've been really good at managing, but we want to make sure that we put a stop to risky situations.
So you're going to be supporting that today then?
Yes, I will be supporting it. One of the discussions we'll have though is, you know, what are we going to do if people show up at buses and don't have them? You know, and so those are the things
What are the consequences that you have to look at in terms of, you know, what happens if you're not wearing a mask on a train, on a plane, fines? Is that what you will be looking
at? Actually, we've already had a test of this because at level two we did it. And there we found that actually people did wear masks, and it was fantastic. It meant we didn't have standoffs at public transport and things like that. So it'll be about how do we bring it in, what time frame do we bring it in over, making sure people know it's not just masks, face covering, scarves, they all you know, matter, they all make a difference if done well. So making sure as well that we're leaving it with the police to monitor and enforce, not other passengers as well.
COVID Tracer app, also looking at that becoming mandatory, having to use that?
Well, actually what we're looking at, and it's very hard to say you know every single person must scan wherever they go. So we've got to be practical around what works and what doesn't. What we're looking at is in those higher risk environments, and we know what they are, you know, those bigger mass gatherings, it's wherever it's hard to find people afterwards. What can we do to make sure we've got a good register of who's been at them? So there's lots of ways we can do that. So we're going to take a little longer to consider that one.
I just want to go back to the mask. Final question on COVID-19. Why has it taken so long when we've had Professor Hendy, we've had Professor Michael Baker asking for masks to become mandatory.
And so again,
for everyone, because we know that the virus is up and down, right?
Yeah, but keeping in mind that when we've had the virus amongst us, we've tended to be at level two, where we've had compulsory mask use. It's only been recently where we've actually said, actually, at level one, there will be circumstances where we'll have COVID cases and we're at level one. So let's bring that consistency in the way we're treating mask use. We have always encouraged it, though, so we've never stopped encouraging it. But we as government have to think about everything. We have to think about how do you enforce it? What do you do for low-income people who can't access those face coverings? How do we make sure that we don't have vigilante reaction to people not wearing them? So we've always got to think about the whole picture.
All right, let's talk about out-of-control house prices. It was revealed on Friday that the national median house price had risen by 20% in the past year. Will you intervene? How will you address this?
And look, there is no question that over the period of 3 years, we have been. It was only a few months ago at the beginning of COVID that we were talking about the potential collapse of the housing market. That just hasn't happened. So what we have already done on the demand side, banning foreign buyers in the market, closing tax loopholes, we increased the bright line test to stop people flipping houses.
So if you're doing that, then why are we in this situation?
Yeah, and there'll be a number of factors here. What's interesting is that at this stage, people are saying it's not necessarily the case that it's a population issue. We've closed our borders. There's not the suggestion at this point that the number of Kiwis coming home is actually adding to this heat in the market. I'd say there's a number of factors, one of which will be low interest rates. You know, it means that people are feeling more able to enter the market. But you just look at the numbers. Our number of first home buyers has actually increased. Our investors has stayed the same. So we are continuing to look at ways that we can help first home buyers in, but not have too much heat in the market. Looking at whether or not we can help a bit more with what happens with deposits. You've seen
that's the big part for a lot of people trying to get into the housing market, right?
Massively.
The interest rates are so low, so you can afford
the mortgage payments,
but you can't afford the deposit.
So that's where I've asked our team, look, let's pull together some advice on some of. We have a couple of things we use at the moment where people can use their KiwiSaver and reduce down the amount of a deposit they need. Let's look at that again. It's useful higher than it is. We've got progressive home ownership we're rolling out. That basically, again, helps with the deposit. I want to keep looking at those ideas. Helpfully, what the Reserve Bank has done is say, at the same time, we want to put in some measures that will stop too much heat in the investment market.
But later in the interview, but can I just ask you to pull your mic down a little bit on the other side? Your hair's just getting caught in it.
Animated talking about housing.
Let's talk about the diplomatic meeting or hui that you've been having over the last few days. You've been involved in three international hui. Well, I want to talk about the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership that was signed yesterday, trade deal. So what are the benefits for that for us here in New Zealand?
Yeah, and so this was our first virtually signed trade agreement, which was an interesting experience itself. This has taken 8 years to negotiate. It's the largest trade agreement in the world. It covers 15 countries. Most of the countries who have signed up, we already have trade agreements with. The big benefit for us, it creates a single rule book. So when our exporters are trading, they have to know some of the different requirements across the countries they're trading with. This will cut a lot of red tape. Also means that actually there's some requirements on those countries, for instance, to clear perishable goods in really quick timeframes. Overall, we're predicting about $2 billion worth of benefit to New Zealand from that. The other benefit, India was at the table.
Yeah, pulled out, right?
They pulled out. Mm. And India being at the table will be big for us. So being part of that agreement for when they eventually may choose to re-enter is a big deal.
Why do you think they'll re-enter?
Well, it is quite political. I mean, they made the call not to be part of the agreement, but they were there for most of the negotiation because domestic political issues. If you've tended to protect some of your industries, then sometimes you'll stick with that. It's not to say that in the future they wouldn't change their position.
Prime Minister, we appreciate you and thank you so much for joining us this morning and coming into the studio to be with us.
Peter.
Thank you so much.